joins me now live in studio. First of all, Senator Paul, we're so glad you're on the mend. Welcome back. It's good to see you. So you were one of the handful of Republicans who voted against the measure. You say it's because you don't like these short-term spending bills, what are called continuing resolutions, as opposed to a long-term budget plan. You also feel this proposal adds too much to the deficit. Your party's leadership has been quick to blame Democrats for the shutdown, the so-called Schumer shutdown. But there weren't even enough votes necessarily to pass this among Republicans.
I think the blame game is ridiculous on both sides. Republicans and Democrats and everybody trying to say, oh, you don't want to fund the military. Everybody wants to fund the military. Nobody wants our soldiers not to be paid. But when both sides do it, I think the American people see through it. It's gamesmanship and it's partisanship. I gave them the answer. Here's the answer how you solve this today. Promise, guarantee in writing to the Democrats that there will be 1 week's debate on immigration and a vote on an immigration bill sometime in the next month in the House and the Senate. Now, when I presented this to those in the Senate, Senator Durbin, they're like, oh, no, we want it guaranteed passage on a must-pass bill. And it's like, well, nobody gets a guaranteed passage, so I don't think they're going to get that. But what about a guaranteed week, open amendments? I get to present amendments, everybody does, which rarely ever happens. Do the same thing on the House side. You'll get two different bills, go to conference, work out our difference, and there could be an immigration bill that comes forward in the next month. I think that's very doable. The reason it's hard on the spending bill is we don't all agree on what the fix is to immigration. And rather than try to work out a deal in advance, put it on the floor and let the deal work itself out as the legislation comes to a conclusion.
Well, one of the confusions, as you know, is what will President Trump be willing to sign?
He'll sign whatever comes out. You saw him saying, remember that meeting where he says, you work it out and I'll sign it?
Yeah, but then the next week, Durbin and Graham came forward and said, here's a bipartisan bill. Right. We think it can get 70 votes. And he said, no.
The problem is those people with the bipartisan bill, and I'm for some aspects of that. I am for some middle ground. The people with that bill want that bill. No, I want an open process so where we vote on these things. But I guarantee you, if you send to the president an immigration bill that passes the House and the Senate, there's no way in the world he's vetoing that.
Well, you have good relationships with people in the House. Is Speaker Ryan willing to do that? As you know, Republican speakers in the past, including Boehner, but also including Ryan, have been reluctant to even bring that up because they don't want a bill that passes with some Republican support. Right. And a lot of Democratic support.
That's the difficulty. But there is a bill over there that Raul Labrador and Goodlatte have that if they start with that, I think they'll still have the nucleus of that bill that passes. And I think a majority of Republicans would support it. But I don't know. I think the process needs to be allowed to work out. I'm kind of a believer in we were all elected. Let's vote on issues and let's vote on amendments to issues. And I won't win all the time. The Democrats won't win all the time. But something will come out. And the thing is, the DACA issue has been held hostage to people on the left who want their perfect immigration bill or nothing, and people on the right who want nothing. And so really, I'd say, let's vote on it. Let's just put it forward and vote on it. And I think the impasse could end today if Republicans would promise just to have a week of immigration votes, have a conclusion, let us all put forward amendments. I think the American people would like to see us hash out our differences through amendments and votes.
So I know people on the right of your party are reluctant to support anything that provides any sort of legal status for anybody in this country illegally, including the Dreamers, who were brought here as children. And there are people on the left who are reluctant to support anything that contains any funding for the border wall.
Right.
Would you theoretically, I'm obviously not pinning you down on any legislation, but would you theoretically be willing to support something that has the border wall money you support and also a path to legal status for the Dreamers?
It has to be a compromise like that. So there's going to have to be some middle ground. I'm actually a fiscal conservative that does not want to throw the kitchen sink at the wall either. So I'm not for spending $40 billion on a wall because I think that's outrageous. $21 million a mile is outrageous. But I am for some form of wall. I'm for trying to have more merit-based immigration. And I'm also for having the chain migration be more the nuclear family and not the extended family. So there are those reforms that could come forward. And I think that it's eminently doable. And where you find the middle ground is you vote. You vote on the amendments, and whichever amendments have the most votes get put into the bill. And there will be a difference. I think the House will be much more conservative than the Senate. And I think that something will pass the Senate. Senate passed the immigration, the Gang of Eight bill, you know, a couple years ago.
Yeah, but the House wouldn't even take it up.
Well, that's why I think the deal needs to be, and this is what I think Schumer should ask for, is I want the House and the Senate to have 1 week on immigration and a vote sometime before the deadline, March 5th. I think that's a reasonable ask and something we could do.
I know you want to talk about the reauthorization of FISA, which is the NSA's surveillance program. You're a vocal opponent of the program, saying it gives broad powers to intelligence services to conduct surveillance not only on foreign nationals but also on American citizens. The president tweeted on Friday, quote, just signed 702 bill to reauthorize foreign intelligence collection. This is not the same FISA law that was so wrongly abused during the election. I will always do the right thing for our country and put the safety of the American people first. Is the president right that the bill he signed won't allow any collection of data from Americans?
I think the intelligence community and their apologists, which are Speaker Ryan, Leader McConnell, they want to give enormous power to the intelligence communities, and I think there's too much power. This program is supposed to let us spy on foreigners in foreign lands, but when a foreigner talks to an American, they get caught up in the database. So if the president calls a foreign leader, he's in the database. If I call a foreign leader, I'm in the database. If you're a businessman or woman and you call foreigners, you may be in the database. If you're a journalist and you send an email to someone in the Middle East that's one of your correspondents, and you type in the words El Baghdadi because you're interested in the leader of ISIS, and you type that in, guess what? You're in the database. And so then we have this enormous database, and they can search Americans, your name. Your name could be typed in. My name could be typed in without a warrant. All we've asked for is keep the program, but get a warrant if you want to search an American's name. And this, I think, the vast majority of Americans would support if they knew the issue.
So the president's not correct in his characterization?
Well, I think the president, I think his instincts lean in my direction because he feels like there has been some abuse of the intelligence community on his campaign. I think Paul Ryan and others said, oh, we fixed all those problems and this isn't about Americans. It's absolutely untrue. So the people like Peter Strzok, who turned out to be very biased and
the FBI, you know,
tweeted
official,
his mistress and all that, they have the ability to look at the 702 section. People with that degree of bias need someone looking over their shoulder saying, because you're so biased against the president, you shouldn't be allowed to search this without asking a judge's permission.
More oversight. All right, Senator Rand Paul, thank you so much. Keep up the good health and the mending.
Thanks.
We appreciate it. The Trump campaign out with a